So then, because of them, he handed him over to be crucified. Therefore, they took Jesus away. Carrying his own cross, he went out to what is called Skull Place, which in Hebrew is Golgotha. There they crucified him and two others with him, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had a sign lettered and put on the cross. The inscription was, Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews. When the soldiers crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, a part for each soldier. They also took the tunic, which was seamless, woven into one piece from the top. So they said to one another, let's not tear it, but cast lots for it and see who gets it. They did this to fulfill the scripture that says, they divided my clothes among themselves, and they cast lots for my clothing. And this is what the soldiers did. After this, when Jesus knew that everything was now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, he said, I am thirsty. A jar full of sour wine was sitting there. So they fixed a sponge full of sour wine on hyssop and held it up to his mouth. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. Then bowing his head, he gave up his spirit.
His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him. Laid in darkness, the battle in the grave, the war on death was waged, the power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake, the stone was rolled away, his perfect love could not be
forever. He is glorified forever. risen.
He is risen indeed.
Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful morning the Lord has given us to be in His house to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome each one of you. We've had a wonderful morning so far. For about 500, it began about 6:30 this morning out at our farm, just as the sun was coming up to celebrate the resurrection of Christ. We have another service going on, actually two other services going on this hour as well. And for those that are watching us by the way of live stream, we welcome you to our service today as well. Had the privilege of meeting some of our family that lives out of town, that's back home visiting for Easter. Welcome back home this morning. But also had the privilege of meeting some that this here for the very first time at First Baptist. We welcome you to First Baptist Hendersonville this morning. We're here to lift high the name of Jesus Christ this morning and to just to worship. I want to encourage you to sing with us this morning. There's a Bible there in the pew rack in front of you. As our pastor comes, get that out. Join with us as we hear from our pastor today, sharing God's word, but also just praying that God would show Himself to you in a very special way today. Pastor Chester and I would love to meet you if you're a first-time guest. We're going to be out on the sidewalk out in front of the church between services. Please come by, introduce yourself, let us meet you. Give us that privilege this morning. We not only get to sing in worship, but we also get to pray in worship. And it's time, if you will, just to bow your heads. And I'm going to be praying aloud, but each of us has an incredible privilege as a child of God to go directly to the Father. And so as I pray, why don't you just spend some time? If you want to just pray silently in your heart, if you want to pray out loud, that's okay too. But would you spend a few minutes just praying and spending time in fellowship with the Father? Our Lord, as we're gathered this morning, we thank You that we can lift our voices together in musical praise to You. Lord, You are the one that we're singing to this morning. But we also thank You that we have the privilege to pray, that we can spend time with You and fellowship with You. And while there are hundreds of people all praying at the same time, thank You that You can hear every one of us individually and You care about us. Lord, You have blessed us by allowing us to gather this morning on this beautiful resurrection day to celebrate, to thank You, to express our love for You, for what You've done for us. You loved us so much that You sent Your only Son, Jesus Christ, to this world to seek and to save the lost. And we were lost, but because of the shed blood of Jesus Christ, Lord, we thank You that now we're Your children. Lord, we thank You that it was buried. Jesus was crucified according to the Scriptures. He was buried, but He was resurrected on the third day. And we have life, abundant life now, and eternal life. Lord, we celebrate. We thank You. We give You the honor and the glory that's due Your name. Lord, this morning, would You anoint our pastor? Fill him with Your Holy Spirit. Give him clarity of mind that comes from You this morning. May his words be Your words today. Lord, I pray for each of us here today. We know Your word has the ability to speak to us right where we are in life. For those that need Jesus Christ, I tell you, pray today is the day of salvation. Lord, may all of us be refreshed and once again realizing all that You've done for us, and may the result be an outpouring of our love for You through Christ Jesus. Amen.
I'm Eric.
And I'm Sarah.
Now, we have two children, Lawson and Anderson.
We were gone for 4 years and relocated back to Hendersonville and enrolled our oldest son into the We Mother's Day Out program, and then just kind of started coming to church more regularly, made it a part of our Sunday morning routine. So I met a couple other local moms through the We program, and through them they invited us to a connect group, which was good because it gave me personally a sense of community as a new mom, as someone that moved back and knew no one. I was able to really lean into those friendships of people that we were walking through the same seasons of life with.
Connect Group was fantastic because it gave us the ability to be plugged into a community of people. It was so good because you got to talk about your personal life, but also get to learn more about the Bible. For me personally, connecting with other believers helped broaden my relationship with Christ, and that led to me making the decision to get baptized.
Who is Jesus Christ to you?
Lord and Savior.
Looking back, prior to getting baptized, I realized that there's a void that we try to fill with different things that society says are important, but you quickly realize the only thing that can fill that void is Christ.
I think one of our biggest fears about joining a large church was just feeling like that we weren't going to be able to find a group of people to connect with, and that we are just ultimately really thankful for the people that the Lord has put in our life and the work that it has done for our family.
Thankful for that testimony this morning. And because Christ is raised, we're raised with it. And that's what this song kind of says. Listen, and then we'll invite you to join us in a little bit. It's our testimony, if you know the Lord.
I was buried beneath my shame, and who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I lay.
I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to
Amen. You can be seated. Thank you.
Was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to view the tomb. Suddenly there was a violent earthquake because an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and approached the tomb. He rolled back the stone and was sitting on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his robe was white as snow. The guards were so shaken from fear of him that they became like dead men. But the angel told the women, "Don't be afraid, because I know you were looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. For he has resurrected, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay."
There's a sign on that door, and it says, "He is not here. He is risen from the dead." We're going to sing what that scripture that she just read, and you can join us in a moment. But let's go back in time, and this is what happened that first Easter morning.
Then on the
Redeemer, lifting me up from the ground. was crucified.
And he went on down to hell. And he took back every key. He rose up as a lion. And he set on Calvary's tree. He's alive.
He's alive.
He's alive.
He's alive.
Praise the Lord into the land.
Man, this is Johnny Cash's home church. I think they did Johnny Cash's song pretty proud. Cole, thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, choir. Thank you to the orchestra. They've been here all last night. They were here and worship, had great, great worship. And I appreciate you all very, very much. They're sitting in the choir loft because if you didn't notice, there's no room for them to come sit with you where they usually do. But that means that we're going to hear one more song at the end. So some of you try to slip out and beat the Methodist. You're not going to beat them today because the parking lot's crowded. So just give over to it. And you want to stay to the very end because they're going to sing another song. And you don't want to miss it. So thank you, choir, for being here all day. Take your Bible and turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. What a great Easter we've had. I was thinking last night about Easter when I grew up, West Highland Baptist Church in Andalusia, Alabama. And I was thinking about the way Easter services used to be and comparing it to this. And this ain't it. This ain't what Easter was when I was a kid growing up, but boy, I like the worship and I just love the energy of celebrating the resurrection of Christ. It's so wonderful. You know, there are a lot of passages in the Bible we could turn to that talk about the resurrection, and many of them that you would think of immediately. Because our faith stands or falls with the resurrection. This is the most important event in the Christian faith. Sometimes people want to get into an argument about which is most important, Christmas when God became a man or Easter. Well, really, there's no question about it, because the reason God became a man was to do what he did as we celebrate the death, burial, and resurrection. This is what it's all about. Had this not happened, we would still be in our sin. This is the event that gives us hope. This is the event that gives us life. This is the heart of our faith. And already by the time Paul was writing some of his works that we now have in the New Testament, there were people asking questions. People were still alive who had seen the resurrection, and yet already, you know, human nature hasn't changed much. And already some people were standing up saying, did that really happen? Is this just a story that somebody told somebody who told somebody? Is this just a myth that has been passed down from generation to generation? How do we really know that this really happened? And so Paul writes really to answer that question. And when I read this passage in just a moment, notice the number of times he uses the word if. I would call the section of 1 Corinthians 15 that I'm about to read the if section. If. And what Paul is saying is, what if it didn't really happen? Now, the entire 15th chapter is wonderful. There are 58 verses. I don't have time to read all that. Read it sometime today. It's a good way to spend some time on an Easter Sunday afternoon. But I'm going to begin reading in verse 12. And I want you to follow along with me. I'll read down to the 19th verse. Look at how many times Paul uses the word if. He said, now, if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our proclamation is without foundation, and so is your faith. In addition, we are found to be false witnesses about God, because we have testified about God that he raised up Christ, whom he did not raise up, if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless. You are still in your sins. Therefore, those who have fallen asleep in Christ have also perished. If we've put our hope in Christ for this life only, we should be pitied more than anyone. Now, there's a lot to unpack in those verses, a lot that we could talk about, but I want to show you three things. I want you to ask yourself the question, what if it didn't happen? What if it's just a myth? What if it's just been passed down? It's legend, like a lot of the other things that we talk about that we know didn't really happen. It's just myth. It's just a story. What if it didn't really happen? Well, Paul addressed that. And this is what he said. He said, if Christ is not raised from the dead, our founder is a fraud. That's what he says there in verse 14. He says, if Christ has not been raised, our proclamation is without foundation. So is your faith. In addition, we're found to be false witnesses about God because we've testified that God did raise him up. Our founder's a fraud. Now, here's the interesting thing about the Christian faith, and you may not have ever thought about this, but it is the only faith, and I don't want to use the word religion because Christianity is really not about religion. It's not about rules. It's about a relationship. But Christianity is the only faith in which a relationship with the founder is absolutely essential. Now, Buddhists don't claim any relationship with Buddha. Buddha died 500 years before Jesus visited Bethlehem in the incarnation, and Buddhists have practiced that religion for centuries, and they make no claim of Buddha being alive or any relationship with Buddha. In the same way, Muslims make no claim about a relationship with a living Muhammad. Muhammad died 600 years after Jesus was raised from the dead. Muslims don't talk about a relationship with Muhammad. All they do is follow the teachings of Muhammad. Buddhists follow the teachings of Buddha. We don't follow the teachings of Jesus. We have a relationship with Jesus. And if Christ is not raised from the dead, then our founder is a fraud. You know, when it comes down to it, there are really only three things you can say about Jesus. Now, these people who want to say, well, he was a great man, but he really wasn't the Savior of the world or the Son of God, those two things cannot go together. He cannot be a great man and have told all the whoppers that he told. There are really only three things you can say about Jesus. One is that he knew what he was saying was not right. He said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. He said, I and my Father are one. He said that he had been here from the very beginning. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. He said that he had been here from the very beginning. He said that if you will tear this temple down, talking about himself, he will build it up again in 3 days. Now, if he said all of those things and he knew they weren't true, he was a liar. He told whopper after whopper after whopper. That's one choice.
The second possibility is that he really thought all those things were true, but he was just off his rocker. He's just crazy. He's a lunatic. He really believed that stuff, but he's out of his gourd. He's out of his mind. He's crazy. He believed it, but it couldn't be true. Either Jesus is a liar who knew all of those things weren't true, or he was a crazy man who thought that they were true, but indeed they were not, or the only other option is that he's Lord. And that everything he said is true. That he is God who came to earth to die on a cross for our sins. And on the third day, he was raised back to life. If Christ is not risen, our founder's a fraud. And this is a scam. But there's a second thing that Paul says. Look at the passage again. He says, if Christ is not risen from the dead, then our faith is foolish. See it in verse 17? He said, if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless. You're still in your sins. If Christ has not been raised from the dead, we are whistling past the graveyard. We've just got a whole lot of stuff that we think makes us feel better, and it's done us absolutely no good. Our sins have not been forgiven. There is no eternity in the presence of the Father. He did not pay the price for our sin. If Jesus is not raised from the dead, our faith is foolish. Now, the reality is that throughout history, there have been battles that wars have hinged on certain battles. In the American Revolution, it was Yorktown. Had things happened a different way, the world would be very different. In World War II, it was places like Okinawa and Normandy. It was places like Midway. Had those battles not gone like they did, the world would be very different. I'm telling you that the greatest battle that ever existed happened on what we know as Good Friday, on a place called Golgotha, where Jesus paid the price for our sin, and suddenly the world went quiet. And the countdown began. Jesus had said, tear this temple down, and in 3 days I'll raise it up again. Jesus had prophesied of these things that were going to happen, and now he was dead and in a tomb, and the countdown starts. Friday passed and Saturday passed. I wonder if it was a little bit like we wait sometimes on capsules that are coming back from outer space and they have to come through the reentry mode. And there's that blackout period where there's no communication. And I know that there has to be a tenseness in those people who are in charge of those things. And they're waiting to hear that radio signal. They're waiting for that word. They're waiting for that voice to have confirmation that they're okay and that they've come through, that communication's been restored. I wonder what it was like during those hours of silence. And on Sunday morning when they got to the tomb and there was an angel sitting there on the stone who said, why are you looking for the living among the dead? He's not here. He's risen just as he said he would. Listen, if Christ is not risen, your faith is foolish. And I've wasted my life. I've wasted my life if this is not real. Let me tell you something else he said right here. Some of you aren't going to like this. This is what Scripture says. If Christ is not risen, our funerals are final. Here's what he said, verse 18. Therefore, those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. All this talk about seeing your loved one again one day, ain't gonna happen. All this talk about gathering around the throne, all this talk about eternity, all this talk about being in the presence of God, all this talk about this place that they've gone, this place that we're going to go, all this talk about heaven and eternity and joy and glory and all of those things, all of that's just hogwash if Christ is not risen from the dead. Let me tell you what this means. If Christ is not risen from the dead, your loved ones are in a hole in the ground. They're in an urn with their ashes or scattered wherever you put them, and you'll never see them again. So when you leave that cemetery, you better say your last goodbye, because there won't be any resurrection morning. And there won't be any gathering around the throne if Christ is not risen. But let me tell you something. Christ is risen, and there ain't no grave that can hold this body down. Let me tell you something. Christ is risen, and that changes everything. We sang it a minute ago. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. I know, he holds the future. And life is worth the living just because he lives. He changes everything. You know what he does? He gives you hope. He gives you purpose. He gives you meaning. He gives you joy. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 8 says he gives inexpressible joy. I'm looking around the room as I've been talking. I've seen a lot of you who I've walked through some valleys with you. You've lost loved ones. You've had tragedies in your life. And yet, even through that, God gives you an inexpressible joy. God gives you purpose and meaning and hope and a future because of his resurrection. All of these things are true. And death is not the end. Because on that Easter Sunday morning, Jesus kicked the end out of his grave, and he made what was a dead end street a thoroughfare that we just passed through. Now, how does a person really experience that? How do you really come to a point where you have that relationship with him? How does a person really have that inexpressible joy, that peace that passes all understanding? That promise of life that is forever. How do you have that? Well, let me share that with you. This is the gospel. I don't want anybody coming to the First Baptist Church of Hendersonville on this Easter weekend without hearing the gospel. This is the gospel. This is what Scripture says. First of all, we're all sinners. Romans chapter 3, verse 23 says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. You're a sinner, and you're a sinner, and you're a sinner, and I'm a sinner. We're all sinners. And then the Bible says in Romans chapter 6, verse 23, that the wages of sin, you know what a wage is, something you earn. You deserve it. It's your wage. We're all sinners, and the wages, we earn this. We deserve it. The wages of sin is death. Now, if there was a period in that sentence, we'd all be in a world of trouble. But there's not a period, there's a conjunction, because the Scripture says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Well, how does God give us that gift? What did he do? Well, Romans chapter 5, verse 8 tells us that while we were still sinners, we're still earning those wages of death. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Well, how do you receive that gift? Well, he tells us in Romans chapter 10. He deals with the heart and he deals with the mouth. And this is what he says in Romans chapter 10. He said, if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, if you believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. But now listen to this part. The next verse says, one believes with the heart, resulting in righteousness. Now, some people don't want to hear that part. What that means is that these aren't just magic words that you just kind of say, hey, repeat after me, and this is your get out of hell free pass. Repeat these words after me, and abracadabra, you can do whatever you want to do, live any way you want to live, go anywhere you want to go, act any way you want to act, and one day you'll go to heaven. No, he said that when you believe with your heart, when you confess that Jesus is Lord, the end result of that, it results in righteousness. That means he changes you. Did you know that God changes his people from the inside out? It's an inside job. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things are passed away. All things become new. So we believe in our heart. We confess with our mouth. And the end result of that is righteousness. And he says salvation. Songwriter said it this way. Not a word was heard that day at the tomb that day, just the shuffling of soldiers' feet as they guarded the grave. One day, 2 days, 3 days had passed. Could it be that Jesus had breathed his last? Could it be the Father had forsaken him, turning his back on his Son, despising our sin? All hell seemed to whisper, just forget him, he's dead. Then the Father looked down to his Son and said,
arise, my love.
Let me tell you something. The same thing the Father said to the Son 2,000 years ago, He says to you right now. The grave doesn't have to have a hold on you. You don't have to be shackled by the things of this world that have corrupted God's plan for you. Listen, friend, God has a plan for you, and it's better than anything you could dream up on your own. He loves you. And He says to you what He said to His Son, arise. No more death sting, no more suffering. How do you do that? Well, you make a commitment like this. You say, Lord, I don't understand everything He's talking about, but I know I'm a sinner. I know I'm a sinner. And if He's telling the truth, if you sent your Son to die on a cross to pay the price for my sin, and if you rose again to give me power over death, then I repent of my sin and I trust Christ who died for me. And I invite you to come into my life and to do that inside job in me. Change me. Mold me. Make me who you want me to be. Scripture says, whoever calls on the name of the Lord. Anybody know what it says? Anyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. If you will call on the Lord, He's calling on you. If you're feeling something in your heart right now, it's not me, it's not the choir, it's not Easter, it's the Lord. He's calling you. And if you'll call on Him, He'll save you. Every week at the end of our service, after I preach, we give an invitation. Well, what are we inviting you to do? We're inviting you to respond to God speaking to your heart. If He's spoken to you, you'd like to talk to me or Bruce. If you'd like to know what the next step is, we've got some people that would love to talk to you about the difference that Jesus has made in their life. Well, I'm in the middle of this row of people. I can't get out. Let me tell you something. They'd love to let you out. Jason, come lead us in a song. If the Lord leads you to respond, He's calling you. This is your opportunity.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength in thee is small. So child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thy all in all. Jesus,
word was heard at the tomb that day. Just shuffling soldiers' feet as they guarded the grave. One day, 2 days, 3 days had passed. Could it be that Jesus had breathed his last?
Could it be that his father had forsaken him, turned his back on his son, despising our sin? All hell seemed to whisper, just forget him, he said. Then the
Let's give the Lord praise. Amen. Amen. God bless you. If you're a visitor, go see the pastor outside. Happy Easter. God bless you. You're dismissed.